when they were deciding who should change my diaper. They were arguing with my Aunt Jan and Uncle Dennis and my dad. That was many, many moons ago. The thing that sticks out in my head here tonight is last year, Bruce and I were hired by Greg to work the outhouse races. Well, we showed up a day early. Thought we'd get a head start on things. Well, Greg was out plowing the driveway and the roads with his cat. Well, he'd done beat himself to death. And looked at us and says, can anybody drive a cat? And I said, well, sure. Well, I've never been on a cat before. Well, Bruce walks me out there, puts me on the cat, gets me going down the road. He's riding shotgun with me. Well, about an eighth mile down the trail, he jumps off and starts walking. He walked the whole old mile road all the way down, clear of the highway and back. He wouldn't get back on the cat because it was rattling him to death. He walked up and back, up and back. We made four passes. Well, we done wore him out with all that walking. Got him up there, and Susan, we had people that were stacked deep in the upper boarding houses there at Effie Camp. And Bruce's snoring was so loud that I think I heard from about 17 people that night that we needed to turn the chainsaw off. But I want to say one thing to you, Susie. I love you. And I gave those three Dots and pickup trucks to Bruce so that he could put one of them together for your daughter. And he took one of them to your house. And I will come and fix that truck for you guys. Well, we'll teach her how. Okay, he taught me how to snore so I can work on it.
Is there anybody else that has something? I mean, Bruce made a lot of friends, did a lot of crazy things, I can guarantee you. That's what endeared him to all of us. Is there anyone else? All right, here comes. Oh, you're next, Teresa.
My name's Danny, and I'm here representing my husband and myself. We weren't as lucky as a lot of the people that are here today. We only got to have Bruce Brooks in our lives for 4 years. And there are two things that really will make me remember Bruce always. The first was the love of his wife, Susan, his children, Brady, Brandy, and Rebecca. Bruce was a consummate family man. And the gratitude that we need to feel for him today, I bet there isn't anyone here that Bruce Brooks didn't help at one time. I remember once he came by because Mark was worried the phone wasn't working, and Bruce came by to check to make sure Danny was okay because it was 50 below. He was just there. I have a couple of things jotted down because I'm not very, my memory's going, and the paper's upside down. Bruce taught me through Gibran that it is when you give of yourself that you truly give. He praised us well and found but the good in all of us. And when the earth shall claim your limbs, then you shall truly dance. Bruce lives with us all that are present here today as his beautiful spirit has entered all of our hearts forever. Thank you, Bruce.
Several warm, really good memories about Bruce, but I gotta say one really sticks in my head that's pretty comical. It's down at Summit Lake, and we're all crammed in the tent on sleeping bags and everything on the floor there. And I don't know how I ended up right next to Ron, and Bruce had blown up this huge mattress to sleep on, and why they were sleeping in the same bed as another one. I don't want to go there. This thing was probably probably a couple feet off the floor by the time they had it all blown up and everything. So it was a little bit of a height difference there. And I find out the next morning that in the middle of the night, Bruce had rolled over and plopped right down on top of me. I never even stirred. I must have been a tired puppy. I didn't know. I heard the next morning he was just mortified and asking, checking me for broken bones and everything else. So we had to kind of razz him about that for a little bit. I think Greg's comment was, no, you ain't heavy, brother. You're just loud. But Bruce is always extremely, an extreme pleasure to take and to put up with, even when he, you know, rolls on top of you and smothers you.
Now, those, for those of you that never had the opportunity to enjoy the tent down on Summit Lake with Bruce and everybody else, and a lot of you here, it was truly an experience. I don't know if they're going to allow us to do that anymore. I think the state's put through a special bill outlawing the Chattanooga Lodge tent down there. It's a lot of fun we had down there. Does anybody else have something they would like to add to it? Here we go. Remember, folks, hey, you're going to think about something there tomorrow or tonight on the way home, and you're going to wish that you had told us about it.
I met Bruce and Susan about 10 years ago or so. And I was reading in the newspaper when I first got up here, there's a real nice cozy cabin on Haystack Mountain. Gotta come out and rent it. So me and my ex got into the old beat up rusty Nissan pickup truck and headed out to Haystack. Bruce come walking out. I didn't know he was Bruce at the time. Big old beard, big old smile. How you doing? Doing okay. Susan right behind her. How y'all doing? I come in here and like to scare the hell out of me. And I rented a cabin from Bruce and Susan and had some wonderful times with them. One story I can remember, I come home late from work one night. Bruce beat me home, which was real unusual when we wasn't spending a couple minutes or two in Fox. And I went home and got myself a beer, and Bruce went in the house and got settled in and walked back out to lock the pickup truck and plug it in for the night. And holy smokes, I seen a bear. So I run up to Bruce's and I'm scared to death. I'd never seen a bear before. I'd seen them, but they're on TV and National Geographic and whatnot. And Bruce grabbed his gun and said, well, let's go get it. No. No, come on, you gotta come with me. We're gonna get it. I'll teach you all about this stuff up here. So I run down and I got my gun, and we can take off to the woods after this thing. And I was scared to death. I was shaking. Oh, I tell you, I was shaking. And Bruce, he was laughing at me, slapping me up in the back. Come on. So we run down out to the bottom of the hill, and we seen a bear go underneath one of the trailers down there on down by the river. And Bruce puts down his gun and puts a knife in his teeth. And he commences to crawl underneath this little trailer house. And he's going to go get this bear. And I'm trying to talk him out of it. I'm trying to push him. Nah, you can't go underneath there with that knife in your teeth. What are you doing? I'm going to get a bear. Oh, my God. This is how they do this up here. These people are crazy. Well, he goes underneath there. And I'm with my flashlight, and I'm trying to see what the hell's going on. I had my gun, and I'm scared to death. I don't want to shoot him, you know. I'm getting ready for what's going on. He comes crawling back out there. I got him. He crawls out from underneath this trailer, and there's this Newfoundland dog right on his heels. I said, what the hell? And I, first when I see the dog, I jump back. And he's petting it and it's licking him. Oh my God. That scared the hell out of me. But I tell you, me and the boys and Bruce mainly, we've had a lot of good times together. That was just one of them. There was not one dull moment with that man. Not one. And he taught me a lot about Alaska. He taught me what a pair of bunny boots were. Him and Sam, they taught me what refrigerator were. I'd stand out there with my Levi's on and my Levi looking good with my cowboy boots on, and they're both slapping me in the back of the head. You're cold, aren't you? Yeah, I'm cold. And that's happened more than once too. He was my first friend I had here in Alaska. That was my first friend, him and Susan and the family. They've been good to me. They've been good to everybody. They've been good to all of you people that know him like I do. And I know exactly how all of you feel, and I'm gonna miss him just as much as you're gonna miss him. I loved him like a brother. He loved me like a brother, and I loved his family as much as he loved mine. And God's gonna let him rest in peace.
You don't suppose he knew that was a dog before he started to put on that brave acting? Oh, this is beautiful. God, I wish we had a recording of this, because this has been fantastic. Does anybody else have one? One more story. Oh, wait a minute, we're going to have a potty break. Okay. Susie says potty break. This means time out. We all know that. Sam and Floyd to sing? What? Is that Floyd leaving? Well, he was a fabulous person. He was common as an old shoe and as loving as could be, and anybody that needed a hand, all he had to do was ask. Didn't let, a lot of times he didn't even have to ask. He'd show up, find out if there's something he could do for him. There's got to be one more story in here somewhere. Oh, Susan was there and knows this story, huh? Okay.
Okay, hold it close.
If not, I think we... Wait. Okay. Okay, you're next, Dean.
That's the kind of tilt that I might have got out of Bruce, too. I've done so much thinking this last week about, oh God, there's this, and there's that, and there's that, and there's that. But one of my first real fond memories of Bruce was how helpful he was when you're really in a dire straits type of situation. We went down to... What? We went down to Summit Lake, and this is the first year that I'd ever been down there for the Arctic Man race, and I didn't have a machine of my own at the time to ride, so Bruce says, well, here, you can use the old SKS, it's a little bit beat up, so thereby if you tumble it, you don't have to worry about it too much, just watch out for yourself. So I'm watching everyone driving up the hillsides and stuff, and I'm thinking, God, that looks scary. I ain't gonna do that for about the first half hour or so. Then I started deciding I had to try that a little bit. And I started figuring, well, it looks to me like they're going pretty much anywhere as they want to go. So maybe I can do that too. So I decided to do this one climb. And I don't exactly remember how I ended up underneath the machine. But I ended up with my feet dug into the side of this hillside. And I got the machine up above me. And I'm thinking, damn, I wish this machine was mine so I could just jump out of the way and watch it roll down the hill. But it ain't mine. I can't let it go. I'm standing underneath there. And I'm trying to keep the thing from finishing tipping over on me. And I'm trying to kick my feet in a little bit deeper. And all the while, I found out later on that Jeannie Berger was filming some idiot who had gone up there and got stuck on the hillside. Well, as far as I knew, I was completely all by myself out there. Well, it turned out that the three people that noticed me up there was three people I knew. There was the girl running the camera, watching me, and all of a sudden, completely spontaneous of each other, two different guys happened to go, that guy needs some help. That guy needs some help. Well, they both took off, and they both got up there about the same time. They just happened to have been Sam Berger and Bruce Brooks. Little did Bruce know that he was going to go up and try and help out someone that was on his machine. So this is the thing that really stuck with me. Bruce pulls up there, he parks the wide track. Does he come over to help me immediately because he can see how bad a situation I'm in? Shit, no. Bruce looks at me and he goes, Pete, what the hell are you doing here? You know, shit, evidently I'm waiting for you. They got me out of there. They got me out of a bad situation as they did many more times ever since. But there were a couple times Bruce got me in a situation or two. One night, Bruce taught me a lot about riding snow machines, and thank God he didn't teach me everything he knew about it, because I don't know if I could take that. But one night he was going to teach me some stuff about riding on the river and going places where it didn't look like you should ever go. Oh, you can go, Pete. You can go. You just got to... I know you had to turn me before it. Anyways, we started to go, and I'm following him, and we came to several places where I'm going, Bruce, it don't look to me like we ought to go this way. And he's going, well, there's only two choices, and that's turn around and go back, or to keep going forwards. And we ain't turning back. He says, we ain't turning back till we're beat, and we ain't beat yet. So we shooting across different open channels on the river and stuff. And one by one, they got a little bit nastier looking until we finally got to the point where he says, we're standing there looking at this channel. This is at night, of course. So you got the limited visibility there. And he's going, well, okay, we're beat now, Pete. But we can go back. And I'm thinking, yeah, but a couple of open leads back, didn't we kind of jump off a little shelf to make our crossing and in our endeavor to ever go forwards? So, you know, it's some of those situations you got to look at them and go, well, should we really go forwards? Because if we run into something too nasty, are we going to be able to go back? Well, we had to go back. So we're looking at this one really, really nasty section, and I'm looking at this angled shelf over on the other side of this thing, and it wasn't really tall, but you know, in the middle of the night, and you ain't never done it before. And to tell the truth, I guess actually now I would still be a little bit concerned about it. Bruce goes, as I heard him say so many times, and as you guys probably heard him say too, and it just sounds all the more sadder now to think about it, he says, oh, I'm gonna die sometime, Pete. Let's go. He said, don't even think about it, just follow me. Well, I'm glad that I waited for him to go across first and waited for a second. I waited till he hit that other side. Then I went. Well, I didn't wait to see how he turned out on the other side. I was just looking at that lip of ice there. And I hit that sumbitch and I kind of flew up in the air. And all of a sudden I realized that you guys all seen a deer or a moose or something that's been hit by a car. And there they are, they're rolling around, you know. And shit, if he hadn't hit a moose, there was a moose rolling around off to the side of his machine. So all of a sudden, what was a tight situation, I had to hit this ice at the right angle. There's a snow machine and a moose over here. But with my determination to not run into this moose and getting in a worse situation that I was just getting out of, I managed to shoot right between Bruce's machine and the moose. And I didn't have long to consider about why Bruce didn't get out of there quicker before I realized that moose, and you guys all know how big Bruce was, so you won't take me to task for mistaking Bruce for a moose. Almost running off. Anyways, I've been taking some different guide trips for the snow machine rental here over the last few years, and the very first time I took some people up into the mountains, we had three Frenchmen wanted to go riding. They wanted to go for a big adventure. So Sam says, "Well, Pete, I got faith in you to take people around here, but go way the hell out there." Says, "I gotta send someone with you that I really, 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 really got a lot of faith in." And you already heard his take on it earlier on about when he put himself out there with no one else to trust and rely on. Bruce is the one he took with him. So he sent me with Bruce, which was a lot of fun, and thank God I'd already slept in tents and cabins and stuff with Bruce there beside me for, and I slept in room 3 here while Chattanooga Days was going on, and people are screaming in the hallways, and I slept in that trailer out there while snow machines are buzzing by at 5 o'clock in the morning, so I can sleep through pretty much anything. So I could sleep through Bruce's snoring. I had no problem with it. But these three Frenchmen who insisted all the way through the trip, "Oh, no problem, I got a friend back home snoring real bad." I'll just go ahead and cut the long story short and say that the next day, all three of them agreed. The only time we got any sleep was when Bruce woke up to go outside and take a pee. Every time he went outside, we fell asleep. Every time he came back inside, we woke back up. God damn it, Bruce. So, anyways, Susan had that request that we get up here and play for Bruce. Anyways, one of the things that she really liked, Susan really got a kick out of this, was when we get Bruce and some of the other guys up here and they'd sing along with us. That was a lot of fun. And you know, sometimes Bruce would really sing his ass off, but you know, half the time he'd get up there, he'd stand there and he'd go, "Bruce, sing in the microphone." He'd go, sound good. And that. Anyways, we're going to do that a little bit later on here. We're going to get a couple of special friends up on the stage, and they may not even think it right now, but they're going to get up here. And they probably already know who they are. They've been up here with them before. They've been a rare occasion. In fact, these are some of the same guys that have actually, when they were so hard up for female companionship, that listening to me and Teresa playing music, they had to offer to dance with a folding chair. And Bruce did too, and he was probably the one who embraced that chair the tightest. I know that Bruce's family wants to thank you guys for all showing up here. And I want to thank you too, because Bruce meant a hell of a lot more to me than maybe a lot of you can even imagine, but I love that guy.
Yeah.
Dave, you have something?
Some of you folks might find out something totally new about it.
All I can say now is that he's up there with her. That's it.
We're all going to miss him for sure. And he's one of those rare people who comes down the pike. Is there anybody else in other prayer? Dear Lord, we're here today to remember and rejoice in the life and good times that Bruce brought to our lives and into our world. We trust that you will comfort Susie, Brandy, Becky, and Brady in the sorrow of losing a loving husband and father, and that you will help his many friends through this difficult time. We ask this in the name of the Lord our God. Amen. Thank you all so much for coming out and celebrating Bruce's life, because it was short, but he did a hell of a job at it. He did a good job at it. Okay, thank you very much, folks. Be sure, all of you that are here, make sure that you get your name in the book here, please, for them. And there's pictures around here that might remind you all of something that happened in your experience in life with Bruce. Thank you.
There's just one day on that climb up.
Walk up there and move the stars.
We can always climb that mountain.
Oh, yeah.
This is the end of the road now.
This is the Bruce. We're all lying here. Back, where are you from? Well, you can't be up in there. There's all the rest of us came from.
Come on, you have to get up in there.
No.
You need a bigger stage.
Don't you even think about taking it.
Whoa. We need ramps up.
Come on, Elliot, you get up there. You're just about Bruce's size.
Got it. Oh, that's too many now. Gramps is up there.
Oh, Gramps is up there?
Yeah. I wanna play
me
some night.
All right,
we're
gonna
start this.
Want me to get up there?
Way up north.
Oh, Elliot.
Way up north.
Yeah. Let's start
off. Oh, to Alaska. The rest is on. Oh, to Alaska. North, the rest is on. Big Sam, bless you. Yeah. You're gonna deal with your private partner and burning bill too. If I see you come river and pound the bananas of gold, blow that old white mountain a little south east to go. Sam, cross the majestic mountains, the valley's far low. The art and fame is the team of us, just as it must down through the snow. With his gold in his hand. Say, look out, Sam, you're looking at a mighty lonely man.
He's a
hot
dog.
All the gold they got there in the this land. For one small band, a golden place, sweet little jealous man. Cause a man needs a woman to love him all the time. Remember, Sam, a true love cost you not more than a dime. I built for my Jenny girl in a honeymoon home. Blow that old white mountain a little south east to go. Winter river is wide. Whose blood is ever in the north? To Alaska, don't go to Russian Island. To Alaska, don't go to Russian Island. Way up north, way up north.
says I'm gonna run
to a shop in the air so I can run.
He said I'm gonna give it my best and I'm gonna lay down. And then he went on that old white track.
You're one of the ones that Bruce got really animated on a couple times. What are you doing now? You remember this one.
Hey, Pete. I think Floyd knows this song.
Well, I can sing my own song.
Oh, what?
I was picking through your keyhole, she knocked me flat.
Stop, Ross.
You ready over there, Teresa? You ready over there? I ain't ready over here, but I think all these guys are ready. There she was, just a walking down the street, singing.
Sometimes I get whiskey and now
Bruce was here, Bruce would be right up there.
I showed up in boots and ruined your entire affair.
I was the last one to show.
The last one to show.
I was the last one you thought you'd see there. Saw the surprise and the fear in your eyes as I took a glass of champagne. Like those two years ago, we made it through. You'll never hear me complain. Places where the whiskey drown and the beer chases my blues away. And I'll be okay. No, I'm not big on social graces, and I slip on down to the oasis. So I got friends.
That's right, we're in the men's bathroom.